Everybody, please forgive the technical issues that we had to address before beginning. My name is Dr. Ashwin Mehta, and I welcome you all to this afternoon Lunch and Learn series. I'll be talking to you this afternoon about integrative approaches to optimum sleep. So I think, you know, a lot of people have heard this term of integrative medicine. Well, I'm an integrative medicine physician. I'm an internal medicine physician by training. But in addition to that, I have specialized training in how to use nutrition and exercise and sound sleep practices along with mindfulness and relaxation techniques in order to really achieve optimum health and wellness from a preventative standpoint, and then also to make sure that whatever mainstream medicines we use in common practice work as well as possible. So I have no financial disclosures that are relevant to this talk. And I'd like to start up by just opening up with a couple of questions, just to wake you up a bit, and also to introduce you to this field of integrative medicine and sleep. So, as sleep pertains to chronic pain, we have a lot of a very interesting legal situation that's going on with pain management clinics in the state of Florida. Chronic pain is a very, very common problem, as are sleep disturbances, and oftentimes they go together. Which of the following modalities have demonstrated promise towards addressing the symptom, the cluster of symptoms, including pain, fatigue, and sleep disturbances in cancer patients? Would that include cognitive behavioral interventions, including mindfulness, exercise, yoga breathing, pranayama? And the answer is actually all of the above. There are interesting pilot studies that have been done that actually validate the use of yoga breathing, including pranayama, to address this cluster of symptoms that include pain, fatigue, and sleep disturbances, which are very common in the context of my clinical practice. So predominantly, I'm at the Sylvester Comprehensive Cancer Center. That's where I spend most of my time. And this symptom cluster of negative mood, sleep disturbances, chronic pain, and fatigue is very common in the clients that I see. So we have to figure out how to break this cycle, and I'll be explaining to you a little bit about how these symptoms are actually related and in fact cyclical, so they build on one another, and that's why an integrative approach which breaks the cycle makes the most sense. So my objectives for this afternoon are to talk about the interrelated nature of sleep conditions, chronic pain, and negative moods, as well as inflammation. We hear a lot about inflammation. It's getting a really bad reputation nowadays. Well, it needs to, actually, because while inflammation is an important thing that our immune system uses to fight infection and to ward off disease, it's also chronically, if it's not turned off appropriately, it can cause significant problems in the body, including leading to things like heart conditions. I'm going to talk about the importance of a multidisciplinary approach to sleep concerns, and I'll also be talking about promising integrative modalities towards addressing sleep disorders. So sleep is a very, very interesting field. What really drew me to sleep as an area of study is the fact that most disciplines within medicine are organ-based subspecialties. They are the study of the heart, the kidneys, the lungs. What's interesting about sleep is that it's a behavioral subspecialty. So it really encompasses so many different organ systems all at the same time, which is what I find fascinating about sleep. One of my mentors in sleep medicine at the University of Miami would say that sleep is a four-movement symphony. So if you describe, if I oftentimes describe sleep as a four-movement symphony, because if every single organ system in your body is a different instrument section, they all have to play in a very coordinated manner to get from one stage of sleep into the next and into the next. And a lot of sleep conditions that are very common stem from the fact that our brains are still in a state of hyperstimulation and agitation and arousal, whereas the rest of the body is saying, I'm tired, let's get some rest. So that sort of incongruence between some organ systems and and others often is what contributes to sleep conditions. So there are four different movements to this symphony, stage one, stage two, and then the deeper stages of sleep, which include stage three and REM sleep. Sleep is a multidisciplinary field. We have on faculty at the University of Miami Sleep Division, we have psychiatrists, we have neurologists, we have pulmonary and critical care physicians, we have pediatricians, and internal medicine physicians. So there's a lot of, and as well as ear, nose, and throat surgeons. So there are a lot of people who are involved with treating sleep conditions at the University of Miami. That's kind of another thing which drew me to sleep, is that it's such a multidisciplinary field. It's a growing science. We are just beginning to unravel the full mysteries of sleep. It's interesting to hear about the neurobiology of sleep and this communication that's happening between the brain and your digestive tract while you're sleeping. Well, the communication that's happening between your immune system and your brain while you're sleeping. And all of these things we are finding have very significant health implications. And it's a behavior-based subspecialty. What's interesting is that nobody has been able to explain to me why this symbol, the Chinese yin and yang, is actually the emblem for the American Academy of Sleep Medicine. Well, my interpretation of this is that in every period of nighttime sleep, it's okay to have a few minutes of wakefulness. And conversely, during every period of daytime wakefulness, it's okay to have a little nap, a little siesta. Part of what contributes to sleep concerns, particularly insomnia, is our misconceptions about sleep itself. We are such a performance-driven, hyper-performance-driven society that we feel like sleep is somehow lazy or not important, but it's actually extremely important. And the way that I kind of describe it is that if we were to make a list of all of the things in this room, there are people, there are chairs, there's a podium, but very few of us would put space as on that list. But if you look, space is actually the thing which occupies the most volume in this entire room. Yet it might not be on most of our lists of things that occupy this room. And that's actually exactly how we miss sleep. We miss the importance of sleep because our focus, our attention, is on what we need to accomplish during the day. However, that downtime, that respite that we all need is oftentimes overlooked, and we have misconceptions about sleep. In other words, if we even spend just a few minutes of wakefulness during the nighttime, we oftentimes beat ourselves up and we begin watching the clock and doing this really complex calculation to try and find out how many minutes and how many hours exactly we've been asleep. And then we start thinking about what we have to accomplish the next day, and this kind of leads to a cycle of anxiety and arousal that can actually, paradoxically, keep us awake when the thing that we really want to do is get some rest. So this gentleman is very well balanced. Sleep is a natural and innate process that is inherent to our physiology, okay? No, sleep, everything else that we do during the day is a willful act. We get up, we brush our teeth, we, you know, put our clothes on, we, you know, go to meetings and go to work, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Everything that we do is a willful act. Conversely, sleep is a surrender. Sleep is a letting go. And it's not something that we are hardwired to do. It's not something that we're trained to do because it should come naturally, right? But there's a lot of cultural influences with respect to why sleep is such a pervasive and elusive thing in our society. So I'm going to describe a little bit what integrative medicine is all about. Integrative medicine is a client-centered wellness model. It's a partnership between provider and patient. And we use everything from prevention to treatment. So we span the spectrum of interventions. We use conventional as well as non-conventional modalities whenever appropriate and whenever there's evidence for the use of each. We use natural non-invasive interventions preferentially. Okay? So the whole idea behind using sleep in integrative medicine is to strengthen the immune system and to reduce inflammation, because actually during the deepest stages of sleep is when our immune systems are most active. So this is the symptom cluster that we commonly see, particularly in my practice. Pain, poor sleep quality, fatigue, anxiety, negative moods, including sometimes full-blown depression, poor memory, focus and concentration, as well as metabolic disturbances, oftentimes weight gain, and sometimes even weight loss with sleep loss. So what do we know about the importance of sleep? Why is it important? Well, what we know about the importance of sleep comes from sleep deprivation studies. And reverse, one of the things that's really important for during sleep is to reverse the damage, the oxidative stress that we accumulate during wakefulness. Sleep is important to replete our energy stores. There's a brain and body cooling function that happens, particularly during the deepest stage of sleep, REM sleep. During REM sleep, our core body temperature actually dips a bit, right? And what happens when you sprain your ankle or you stub your toe? What do people say? Well, you should ice it, right? Well, your own body has its own icing mechanism, and that entire brain and body cooling that happens during REM sleep is that's the time that your body is actually initiating its own anti-inflammatory mechanisms to dissolve away that accumulated oxidative stress and inflammation. So it's important for brain development. There's a regulation of ion channels, which are important for your entire central nervous and central and peripheral nervous system. It's important for learning and memory. There's a consolidative function that happens in the brain during sleep. So I like to describe it as kind of defragmenting our hard drives. Well, that's what happens during sleep. When we are bombarded with so much information and light energy during the day, it really makes sense that we need to dissipate that energy, and we need to get rid of a lot of the information, the excess information that we store in our brains, and that happens during sleep. So there's a consolidating function for memory during deep sleep. And it's also important to regulate other physiologic functions, particularly metabolic functions, and I'll get into that. So the physiologic effects of sleep loss. So what happens when you are sleep deprived? Well, certainly it affects your immune system. There is altered immune responses, which we know by reduced natural killer cell activity. Now, natural killer cells are a very aggressive name to this cell, but it's a very aggressive cell. It's like the first line responders of our immune system. So these natural killer cells, we know that the circulating level of natural killer cells in our body actually diminish with sleep loss, okay? So there's a very significant effect that sleep loss has on our immune system because these natural killer cells are fewer in number in circulation. There's also changes in circulating levels of leukocytes and cytokines, and these are pro-inflammatory cytokines, increased TNF-alpha and interleukin-6. So there's also decreased antibody titers of the influenza vaccination. This was all from a study that was done on people who were not sleeping well, they were sleep deprived, compared to people, normal controls who were sleeping well, and they found that the normal controls, their immune systems actually were able to benefit from receiving the flu vaccine and maintain their titers. So your immune system has a memory. And that memory was intact because of adequate sleep. Whereas those people who were sleep deprived, the flu vaccine was less effective. Okay, and of course, the increased inflammatory markers like C-reactive protein. This is sort of the pro-inflammatory cascade that I'll talk about. So sleep loss also affects metabolic hormones. It increases evening cortisol level, increases sympathetic activation, decreases thyrotropin, decreases glucose tolerance, increases ghrelin, and decreases leptin. So there's also endocrine changes that contribute to altered signaling of hunger and appetite. So this is very important. So there's a communication between your digestive tract and your brain that says, you know what, we've eaten enough, stop eating. I get a lot of clients who come in who say, you know what, I have this urge to eat a midnight snack. I have this sweet tooth, and the sweet tooth hits me the hardest at night. After dinner, a few hours after dinner, primarily before going to sleep, what is that all about? Well, what's interesting to note is that evolutionarily, the way that our bodies developed is that stress, chronic stress, was always almost equivalent to drought and famine. Those things were synonymous. So what happens is, when you are chronically sleep deprived, there's an evolutionary feedback mechanism, which actually cuts off the communication between your gut, between your digestive tract and the brain, that allows you to eat whenever there's food available. Well, in our society, food is available, food is abundant, food is plentiful. So if we are chronically stressed, we have a higher tendency to eat. So this is the metabolic influence of sleep loss and sleep deprivation. People who are sleeping well, that communication between the digestive tract and the brain that says, we are good, no more food is required, please stop eating, that communication is intact. For people who have sleep loss or who have any other type of sleep condition, that communication is quieted down. And I've given you a little background for why evolutionarily that makes sense. But the thing is that it's very important to screen for sleep conditions for anybody who has diabetes, high blood pressure, heart disease, and this thing known as metabolic syndrome, because there are a lot of metabolic correlates to sleep loss and sleep deprivation. So this is the cycle of poor sleep, and this is primarily how insomnia develops. So it starts with typically a traumatic event. There's typically, and certainly, you know, being diagnosed or early stages of treatment for cancer count. And this is why sleep is so important in the context of my practice. So there's typically a traumatic event which begins to cause stress and then leads to a cycle of worry, insomnia. There's a hyper arousal state that is oftentimes becomes a habit, actually. Then there's a stimulus response mechanism, which is also very important to note, because the thing is that with chronic insomnia, the way that insomnia, everybody has periods of stress that lead, you know, to one or two nights of poor sleep. That's very, very normal. However, how does that transient insomnia then turn into a chronic insomnia? Well, that is why stimulus response is so important, is because from the acute setting, you begin to associate those things which are related to sleep, and those very things are what cause you stress. That's what's called stimulus response. So that can happen whenever you walk into the bedroom. Because the bedroom is associated with sleep, you think to yourself, well, I haven't been sleeping well the past couple of days. I really hope I get some sleep tonight because I have a lot to do tomorrow. And it's that anxiety, that habitual anxiety that actually transitions insomnia that is related, that happens in a transient state to a more chronic state. So that's why stimulus response is so important. And that's why CBT is so important. I'll talk about how we address insomnia in just a minute. But this can lead to daytime fatigue, poor performance during the day. It can lead to depression. Have you heard of the learned helplessness model for depression? Oftentimes, people get depressed. If they're not sleeping very well, they feel like something that is so simple, something that is innate to the physiology of even an infant, they're not able to do. And there's a frustration that sets in. And that learned helplessness, if it continues, can actually lead to very significant mood disturbances, including full-blown depression. And you know, if you're not sleeping well, what happens is that your substance P accumulates. Substance P is like the communication between your peripheral nerves and the brain, and it relates to your sensation of pain. So your pain threshold actually diminishes significantly with sleep loss. So actually, if you have any reason to be in pain, your experience of that pain will be much worse if your substance P levels are high, as is what happens in the context of sleep loss and sleep deprivation. Okay? And this can oftentimes lead to a hyperadrenergic state. What does that mean? That means that your adrenaline is constantly going, right? Adrenal fatigue is a term that I commonly get asked about. Inflammation, this can cause inflammation and lead to the cycle of increased CRP levels, as well as those circulating cytokines that I was talking about that actually are part of the inflammatory cascade. So this is the cycle, okay? This is how poor sleep can really have very significant metabolic as well as psychological consequences. So insomnia is defined as insomnia is defined as difficulty falling asleep for greater than 30 minutes, 3 times a week for a month. That is the definition for insomnia. Okay. What are the precipitating factors? Typically 62.3% in this one particular study cited worrying about personal problems as one of the most common reasons why people develop insomnia. 52.1% of people identified stress as the precipitating factor. So typically there's a precipitating factor, which is a traumatic event, and then there's a perpetuating factor, and that's why the stimulus control aspect is so important, as I described. So what do we focus on? We focus on sleep hygiene. How many of us have a TV in the bedroom? Wow, this is a very good audience. So most people have a TV in the bedroom. Okay. And what does TV in the bedroom do? Well, TV is a bright light. So anything with a screen, which is typically most things with screens are associated with arousal, my cell phone, my notebook, my laptop, television. So TVs are so bright these days that they trick the brain into thinking that it's still daytime when it's actually night. So that's why TV in the bedroom is bad. And what is important to get into those deeper stages of sleep? Well, melatonin. Everybody's running out to the health food store to buy their melatonin. Well, why is that important? Melatonin is important, but our own brains make melatonin. The signal, the environmental cue that our brains need to start producing melatonin is darkness. So melatonin is a dose of darkness. So when you have that bright TV on in the bedroom, you're going to delay the release of melatonin. And if sleep is a four-movement symphony and every organ system in your body is a different instrument section, then melatonin is the conductor. And it's very important to understand the relationship between these bright lights that we're exposed to and melatonin. So melatonin is a dose of darkness. Melatonin is the conductor, which is important to transition your brain and all of your organ systems of your body from one stage of sleep into the next. That's one movement of the symphony into the next. Okay? So focus on sleep hygiene. What else does that mean? Caffeine intake. Right? We are a hyper-caffeinated society. Caffeine is hidden in so many things that we eat and drink. So just being mindful of that is very, very important. I oftentimes use sleep logs. A lot of times people have a sleep state misperception. They're sleeping, but they don't think they're sleeping. Or somehow they don't think they're clock watchers. These are your clock watchers. They have sleep state misperception. They're sleeping actually better than they think they're sleeping. Okay? And that's why sleep logs are important to identify that. Oftentimes, sleep deprivation is also a very useful intervention. And what that means is just limit the time that you spend in bed to the time when you're tired. Go to bed. Your bedroom should be for sleep and intimacy alone, and that is what is important to keep in mind when we're talking about sleep hygiene. Okay, Sleep deprivation is important because you want to be tired when you go into your bedroom, okay? So oftentimes people just spend, because they're perseverating, because they're preoccupied with the concept of sleep, they're spending way too much time in bed. And if you spend way too much time in bed and you're just kind of like looking, staring at the ceiling, then oftentimes the stimulus control issue kicks in and you end up, and the brain actually gets into the habit of being aroused while you're in bed and stimulated and anxious. And that's not what we want for good sleep. Magnesium. Magnesium is very, very important. Oftentimes in my practice, any combination of high blood pressure, depression, constipation, and poor sleep, I check a magnesium level, and oftentimes it's low. So this is a very easy, simple nutritional and dietary approach to improving sleep quality, and it can also lower blood pressure and improve your mood and alleviate chronic constipation. Vitamin D levels, I check them very frequently. My goal for vitamin D normals are between 50 and 80. Lavender aromatherapy is very, very useful in dealing with insomnia. This has been studied in clinical trials. Lavender aromatherapy actually has an anxiolytic effect. It cuts down the anxiety. So I often say one drop of lavender essential oil on each lower corner of the bed so that it's not in contact with your skin. Or you can use an aromatizer they're relatively inexpensive. There are also good studies that look at meditation, yoga, as well as acupuncture in order to address sleep. And I'm going to be going through some of these in a moment. So meditation is an adjunct to cognitive behavioral therapy. This particular study looked at the impact of mindfulness-based stress reduction on sleep, mood, stress, and fatigue symptoms in cancer outpatients. And what this study found was that overall sleep disturbance significantly reduced in the group of people who were practicing the mindfulness-based stress reduction. Participants reported improved sleep quality. So mindfulness and meditation seem to be very, very important in priming the brain and the body to get into those deeper stages of sleep. Yoga has also been studied, particularly in the elderly population. This study looked at the effects of yoga on sleep quality and depression in elders living in assisted living facilities. This was a group of 55 participants, so a relatively small study, but they performed a yoga exercise program 3 times per week for 70 minutes for 6 months. And this was, I think I misspelled Pittsburgh there. Sorry to anybody who's from Pittsburgh. But this was assessed using the Pittsburgh Sleep Quality Index, which is a very good survey. And overall, participants' sleep quality significantly improved. And depression, sleep disturbances, as well as daytime dysfunction decreased significantly. Now, what we find is that as we age, stage 3 sleep progressively diminishes. So stage 3 sleep is important because stage 3 sleep is most directly related to our subjective experience of how well we slept. So when we wake up in the morning and we say, wow, I felt really good, you might as well be saying, I think I spent a significant amount of time overnight in stage 3 sleep. However, stage 3 sleep progressively declines as we age. And one of the ways of diminishing that decline is by doing these types of physical activities that also include a mindfulness component, and that includes things like yoga and tai chi. So I recommend them very frequently when sleep is an issue. So proposed mechanism of action of some of these modalities, such as yoga as well as tai chi, is that hormonal modulation. Hormonal modulation, the sympathetic-parasympathetic balance, is what is the proposed mechanism of action. So cortisol, in particular, is very, very important. And this hormonal modulation is very important because there are very significant fluctuations in cortisol levels. There's a lower dip in cortisol as we age, in the evening time in particular. So long-term yoga practice is associated with better subjective sleep quality, and long-term yoga practice has a modulatory effect on cortisol levels. So cortisol is kind of your stress hormone, the get-up-and-go hormone. In fact, your cortisol levels peak during the early morning time, and that's because your body's actually priming you for the activities of the day. So cortisol is very important, and cortisol is effectively modulated by practices such as tai chi, yoga, and perhaps other forms of physical activity as well. We also know that massage is very good. I recommend massage very commonly, especially for people who have the combination of chronic pain and sleep condition. So if someone is unhappy with the quality of their sleep and they're having also chronic pain issues, I think that massage is a very good adjunct to mainstream treatment. And this was a study that looked at massage, and this was the substance P that I was referring to. So fibromyalgia pain and substance P decrease and sleep improves after massage therapy. So we refer to massage rather commonly. I've already talked about tai chi. Tai chi actually resulted in decreased sleep onset latency. That means a shorter time between when your head hits the pillow and when you actually fall asleep. So a decreased sleep latency is actually a very good thing. If you have a sleep latency that is greater than 30 minutes, in other words, your head hits the pillow and it takes you 30 minutes to fall asleep, then you're edging into the world of insomnia, okay? Especially if that happens chronically. So overall, longer sleep duration and decreased sleep latency, which are both very good things. So tai chi appears to be an effective approach to sleep enhancement, particularly for elderly individuals, which were studied in this particular research project. I think nap time is very important. You know, for those of us who can afford the luxury of a little bit of downtime, and it doesn't have to be a formal nap. It doesn't have to be, you know, even just pushing away from the desk, doing some deep breathing exercises, and introducing a little space after lunch in your day is a very, very healthy thing to do. Now, the studies on naps have been done really culturally. I mean, there have been sort of anthropologic studies that have been done. You know, the cultures that incorporate a siesta into the daily routine are very good examples. You know, they all seem like happy cultures. I'm a big fan of naps. In fact, I think that one of the best piece of advice that my grandma gave me is after lunch, rest a while, and after dinner, walk a mile. And she's still in pretty good health. So I think that this is something that I use this nap recommendation with a little footnote. Naps are okay as long as you're not having any difficulty or trouble with sleep in the evening time. Okay, because there's two different drivers for sleep. One driver is the night and day cycle, so synchronizing your inner physiology with the external environment, so darkness at night, sleep time, bright and sunny during the day, wake time, right? So that's the circadian rhythm. The other driver for sleep is actually kind of like an hourglass, and that hourglass, we turn over that hourglass in the morning, and when that last grain of sand hits the bottom, that's when the signal goes to our brain that says, now it's sleep time, okay? So what happens when we nap is we put that hourglass on its side, okay? So as long as we don't have any difficulty falling asleep in the evening time, I think naps are okay, okay? But if there are sleeps, if there's a sleep issue, oftentimes I then say, well, sleep deprivation is better, so no naps during the day for you. Let's see what's going on first. So I'm a big fan of developing a sleep routine. I think that, you know, good sleep hygiene we've talked about, a room being quiet and dark, avoiding bright lights, including any kind of screen, no eating in bed. You'll be surprised at how many people are eating cheese and crackers and cookies in bed. Alcohol, caffeine, I would limit alcohol as well as caffeine. Alcohol can worsen snoring and predispose to obstructive sleep apnea if used chronically. Exercise is very, very important because exercise increases your sleep drive. Exercise is one of the ways whereby that hourglass that we turn over in the morning time actually functions more effectively to cue our body and our brain that we need sleep at nighttime. And it's always nice to have an established sleep routine. An established sleep routine may include a mindfulness practice, some breathing exercises, progressive muscle relaxation, okay, a few gentle stretches. A lot of these things are important in order to develop a good sleep routine. Sometimes people I recommend chamomile tea, particularly to those people who have some reflux symptoms that accompany their sleep concern, and that's always a good thing to keep in mind. Chamomile, organic chamomile tea, just one cup before bedtime may be a good idea in those situations. A lot of medications influence sleep. Notoriously, antidepressants. Antidepressants actually suppress our ability to get into the deepest stage of sleep, which is REM sleep, right? So antidepressants are notorious for suppressing REM, and this gets us into kind of a really tricky situation because oftentimes people who are sleep deprived also have negative mood and depression. How do we treat that? Well, we use antidepressants. So we need to be very cognizant of this cycle that can develop in the context of sleep concerns along with depression. And there's all manner of medications typically influence sleep one way or another. Snoring and sleep apnea. So I'll just go through this briefly because it's such a common problem. One of the most common sleep disorders. The risk factors for sleep apnea include snoring, obesity, high blood pressure, observed apneas. If your bed partner is telling you that you stop breathing at night, that warrants an evaluation. Excessive daytime fatigue, increased body mass index or increased neck circumference, increased age, and men are more at risk than women. So these are the criteria that we need to go through to assess for obstructive sleep apnea. Oftentimes it can also be positional. I've had clients come in and tell me that they sleep wonderfully when they're on their side. As soon as they're on their back, they start snoring and they can develop apnea. As well, weight loss. Weight loss is very, very important. Even subtle changes in weight loss can make a profound difference. And exercise. Exercise is extremely important to address sleep apnea. And actually, there's a recent study that was done that looked at the effect of exercise training on obstructive sleep apnea and sleep quality. This was a randomized control trial that looked at a 12-week exercise training program versus a stretching control group and looked at the obstructive sleep apnea severity. So these are all people who had obstructive sleep apnea. The measure of how severe your obstructive sleep apnea is actually known as your AHI, which is the apnea hypopnea index, and that's a measure of how severe your obstructive sleep apnea is. So they looked at everybody's AHI in the context of this exercise training program, and what they found is that irrespective of changes in body weight, that your apnea hypopnea index actually reduces with exercise. So what that means is that there's something else other than the body's soft tissue compressing this airway. There's something else at work with respect to keeping this airway open. And we think that oftentimes Exercise actually tonifies those delicate muscles that maintain this airway open. Okay? If you look at these muscles in the head and neck, which are responsible for keeping this airway open both during wake and sleep, they're very delicate. They're about the size, if you look at the tines of a fork, that's how thin some of these muscles are. So with chronic snoring, what ends up happening is that vibratory damage and chronic inflammation actually begins to damage the muscles and nerves responsible for keeping that airway open. And so over time, the airway gets floppier and floppier and floppier. We begin to snore, and then we end up developing full-blown obstructive sleep apnea, okay? And that's how snoring can lead to obstructive sleep apnea, is because of that vibratory damage and chronic inflammation. So this study looked at apnea hypopnea index, and it found that in people who were exercising, the apnea hypopnea index actually reduced irrespective of body mass change, in other words, weight loss. And that's a very interesting and important observation. So that's the reductions in apnea hypopnea index as well as the oxygen desaturation index were achieved without a significant decrease in body weight. The improvements in actigraphic sleep, an actigraph is like a motion detector which can pretty much tell roughly when you're sleeping and when you're not. Improvements in actigraphic sleep and subjective sleep quality were also noted following exercise compared with stretching. So this is very important. So this is proving that exercise is extremely important to achieve good quality sleep, good quality rest, and also has a very important anti-inflammatory function, exercise does. And this is, I've talked about this a little bit already. This is the cycle of obstructive sleep apnea, which can start with something like weight gain and snoring. So it begins with weight gain and snoring, that inflammation that I was talking about, increased airway resistance, those damaged muscles that I was talking about, the airway dilators, which can lead to dips in your oxygen desaturation at night, your oxygen levels go low, and your heart doesn't like that. Your heart and lungs don't like when you stop breathing at night. That can lead to pulmonary hypertension, ventilatory instability, and full-blown sleep apnea. Now, what happens? When you stop breathing, when you're sleeping, the only way that your brain has to wake you up is by sending a burst of adrenaline. And what ends up happening is this apnea hypopnea index is actually a count of how many times you have a respiratory disturbance that is so profound that your brain actually has to send out a burst of adrenaline to wake you up, which is good because these muscles tense up again and you start breathing again. But it's bad because every time your body is trying to get into those deeper, more restorative stages of sleep, you're getting bumped back into the lighter stages of sleep. So that's why obstructive sleep apnea is very, very important to screen for and treat. These bursts of adrenaline that happen in kind of a pulsatile way at night, they oftentimes can lead to arrhythmias during the day. So anybody with atrial fibrillation or any other types of common arrhythmias also need to be screened at least for obstructive sleep apnea. This adrenaline at night can lead to high blood pressure during the day, as well as an insulin resistance. So there's, along with those other metabolic consequences that I was talking about, regarding the communication between the gut and the brain and satiety, there's other things that can also happen from a metabolic standpoint, including developing insulin resistance, and oftentimes even full-blown diabetes. So sleep apnea is a risk factor for things like high blood pressure, heart disease, stroke, diabetes, and even depression. So it's very, very important to screen because this is something that is very common in our society and oftentimes very underdiagnosed. So this is just a point about inflammation and exercise. I've been over this a little bit, and it's kind of a busy slide. Suffice it to say that exercise is one of the most important anti-inflammatory mechanisms that we have. Okay, and this is kind of a slide that looks at some of the changes in these pro-inflammatory the circulating levels of these pro-inflammatory cytokines with exercise as compared to without. Nutrition and sleep. There are some dietary nutrients associated with short and long-term sleep duration. And this is data from a nationally representative sample. What we find is that lower vitamin D levels are associated with circadian phase delay. So I commonly screen for vitamin D deficiency. Decreased lycopene, thiamine, total folate, folic acid, and dietary folate equivalents are also associated with very short sleep. Decreased phosphorus, magnesium, iron, zinc, and selenium are also associated with very short sleep. right? So now, these are associations, okay? That doesn't mean that there's not, that doesn't mean that there's a causative effect, but it's important to consider dietary interventions, particularly as they pertain to vitamin D levels as well as magnesium. And you know, I oftentimes recommend in conjunction with proper sleep hygiene and good exercise, good regular physical activity, I oftentimes recommend a nutritional plan which encourages an anti-inflammatory, more Mediterranean diet, which is rich in things like lentils and beans and fruits and vegetables and nuts. So, you know, having that as sort of the base of your diet is a very anti-inflammatory kind of diet. Okay, so in summary, sleep disturbances are very, very common. And integrative medicine modalities such as yoga and tai chi and massage and even acupuncture are very useful for some sleep complaints, in especially when you have this cluster of fatigue and depression and chronic pain and poor sleep. Okay, so that's the cluster that we commonly see, and because of all these symptoms in this cluster are related to one another in kind of a cycle. That's why an integrative approach, in order to break that cycle at multiple levels, at a nutritional level, at a sleep hygiene level, as well as a physical activity and exercise level, and then of course using mindfulness and meditation and other relaxation practices in order to prime the brain and the body in order to get into those deeper stages of sleep. All of these are integrative medicine modalities with good evidence, and they're easy. They're simple to do. What's really nice about integrative medicine is that it gives the information and the knowledge about how to achieve good health and wellness to the client. So it's a shared, the onus of responsibility is not squarely on the shoulders of the provider. And that's a very empowering thing, because oftentimes medicine and healthcare can seem like a car wash. You're this passive entity, especially in the context of our cancer center. You're a passive entity, and you're sitting in this vehicle, which is your physical body, and you're on this conveyor belt, and you're moving through, and things are happening to you and being done to you and directed at you in terms of necessary and evidence-based, you know, mainstream medicine, which is important. But you're not an active participant in any of that. That's why it's a car wash. So integrative medicine modalities, this whole client-centered wellness model, empowers the client and individual in order to achieve better health and wellness by using certain lifestyle, using the knowledge of how lifestyle and positive health behaviors can help prevent medical conditions, and also to help treatments work as well as they can. Okay? So lifestyle modification is the core of addressing sleep concerns. And ultimately, stay tuned, because I think the field of sleep medicine and how it relates to the immune system and how it affects so many other physiologic processes in our body. I think that we will learn more and more about how sleep is important for heart health. Sleep is important to strengthen our immune system. Sleep is important in the context of survivorship and living beyond cancer. So sleep is important in so many different ways, which is why we begin with sleep. And the integrative medicine approach, oftentimes people are very reluctant to make significant changes in nutrition, in their dietary habits, perhaps, you know, reluctant to begin an exercise routine, but everybody likes a good restful night of sleep. So I hope I've helped some of you achieve a more restful night of sleep by using some of these methods and interventions. And I think we have a couple of minutes. I'll just open it up to some questions. Thank you for your attention. It is to an extent. You know, actually what we find is that with weight loss, sleep apnea, the severity of your sleep apnea can certainly reduce with significant weight loss. And the general principle is that for every 10 pounds of weight loss, you actually have a reduction in your apnea hypopnea index, the AHI, by 2. And that's a very sort of, everybody's different, because oftentimes people develop sleep apnea because of other anatomic, changes or just anatomic variability, you know, that happens from the tip of the nose down to, you know, where your lungs bifurcate. right? Or where your trachea bifurcates. So oftentimes there's a lot of individual variability there. So it could be anatomic, it could be related to, you know, just craniofacial structures. And that's why ear, nose, and throat physicians are also important to get involved, because they will do these cephalometrics. They will measure certain, they have criteria, and measure the distance between one bone and another in order to determine whether or not you have just an anatomic predisposition to developing obstructive sleep apnea. And in those individuals, surgery is a good option. However, most commonly, obstructive sleep apnea is clustered with the weight gain, increased neck circumference, a long time history of snoring, sometimes accompanied by high blood pressure and of course an elevated BMI. So in those situations, sleep apnea can certainly be reversible to an extent. Whether it can be cured over time, whether those muscles can actually retonify themselves. And structurally regain their integrity. I think that remains to be seen. But I think that certainly with physical activity and anti-inflammatory diet and weight loss, you certainly increase your chances of doing that.
Question. You mentioned a range of 50 to 80. Head towards 80 is better than 50.
We are also a vitamin D deficient society. What we know is that our normals, what's normal, quote unquote, according to the lab value that comes back, is 30 plus. So anybody above 30, there's not going to be any red flag or star by the lab value. But what we find is that from an optimal, immune system function, as well as brain and bone health, vitamin D levels of between 50 and 80 are better. And if they edge closer towards 80, of course, we're happier, particularly in the context of my practice at the cancer center.
Question.
Yes.
Do
you know any studies that associate the microbes in your system with sleep?
It's a great question. I don't, off the top of my head, know of any studies that have looked at because primarily what gets complicated in the studies that look at the probiotics, the good bacteria in our gut, is that there's such a huge spectrum of good bacteria in our gut. So there's no one bacteria, there's no one culpable bacteria that is either that is implicated in good health. It's actually the whole spectrum. And that's what makes studies that look at probiotics so challenging. However, there are a lot of studies on this concept of leaky gut, the sort of inflammation ridden digestive tract. What's important to know is that 40% of our immune system is actually clustered around the GI tract, in these little pockets of immune cells known as mucosally associated lymphatic tissue, MALT, M-A-L-T. So M-A-L-T constitutes 40% of our immune system. And one would think that if we eat foods that actually aggravate those immune cells and cause inflammation, then 40% of our immune system is actually compromised and distracted towards alleviating any kind of bacterial imbalances that occur in the digestive tract, as opposed to, mopping up cancer cells or alleviating oxidative stress in other areas of the body. So it makes theoretical sense that getting good sleep and maintaining sound immune function as a function of getting better quality sleep, sufficient duration sleep, doing physical activity and exercise, and using an anti-inflammatory diet, it would make sense that would lead to a much healthier spectrum of good bacteria in the gut, which ultimately which is proven to lessen inflammation and improve overall health.
If yeast can cause anxiety, maybe that leads into that, not just the probiotics.
Sure.
Negativity.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes, I agree. I agree wholeheartedly. Point well taken. Well, I mean, certainly it could. Certainly it could. You know, I mean, and it does. You know, there are a lot of allergic. You know, and I think that allergies. The relationship between environmental allergies and sort of the pro-inflammatory leaning of our inner physiology. There's a significant relationship there. So what we find is that those people who have dietary food allergies, right, are also more prone to environmental, you know, dusts, you know, pollens and things like that. So what we're seeing is that there's sort of an overall aggravation of the immune system, either by, you know, either environmentally or, you know, from a digestive standpoint, which predisposes to, you know, one or the other. So I think that, you know, certainly, you know, making sure that your air conditioning filter is changed regularly, making sure that, you know, we actually have very good air quality relative to other cities of our size here in Miami, because we get this constant, you know, lovely sea breeze. But molds are not good, especially chronic exposure to molds, and they can oftentimes lead us to this hyper-inflammatory state because our immune system is constantly having to mop up, the spores that we're constantly that we're exposed to during sleep. So it can be an issue, and you know, if there are sinus concerns, there are ways of addressing that. Question.
I do have a sleep apnea, and I've gone through two types of breathing machines, and I've never had a sleep apnea. What's the latest on that?
It's a challenge, you know. As a general principle, only about 50% of people who are prescribed that mask and the machine really end up using it long term. It takes about 1 month. It takes 1 month of a concerted effort to use that mask and the machine on a nightly basis in order to get used to it. It is not an easy treatment to tolerate, particularly if your CPAP pressures are high. So what I would recommend is a couple of things. Give it a real sincere try for 1 month, and couple using this mask in the machine along with some of the other complementary methods that I talked about this afternoon. From a dietary standpoint, getting physical activity. You can, again, like I showed, you can reduce your apnea hypopnea index. You can reduce the severity of your obstructive sleep apnea by doing exercise independent of body weight. So if you lose weight, that's like icing on the cake. But doing exercise in and of itself is going to help reduce the severity of your obstructive sleep apnea. And oftentimes, if you're on a high pressure, what you can do then is go back to your sleep doctor and say, hey, you know what? I've lost 10 plus pounds since you put me on this treatment. Is there any way that we can maybe readjust or identify which kind of, what pressure would be more appropriate for me? Because it feels like maybe it's blowing too hard. And that sensation is causing discomfort and making it more difficult for you to sleep. So there's many ways, kind of, I think that we can use these complementary methods in order to optimize the effectiveness of the gold standard treatment, which is of course the mask and the machine. It's not dangerous. I mean, you know, the thing is, though, that whenever it comes to, and it really depends. If we were in a clinical consultation, it would be, you know, I would advise you based on other things in your medical history. For example, those clients of mine who come in with a history of atrial fibrillation, which is an arrhythmia, and obstructive sleep apnea, I would give a very different answer to that person, as opposed to somebody who obstructive sleep apnea is the only thing in their medical history. They've got no history of palpitations, no history of heart disease, et cetera, et cetera. So the brain and the body are very resilient, okay? So for transient periods of sleep deprivation or lesser quality sleep, we can bounce back from that quite resiliently, okay? However, in the context of other medical conditions, that physiologic reserve actually diminishes. So it's really an individual response. I mean, you know, it's So I would encourage you to get away with it without really knowing more about you.
Is there an optimum time of the day that you should be doing your exercise in relation to evening?
That's a great question. You know, I'm a big fan of morning exercise. And one of the reasons is because that's when your cortisol is peaking. So if your own body's sort of anabolic muscle-building hormones are being produced in the morning time. And that's why I think that, you know, using, it's almost like you're using a tide table to figure out when you're going to go sailing or go surfing. Similarly, with respect to physical activity and exercise, if you time your exercise in the morning, you're actually doing it, you're doing your physical activity and exercise during the time when your own body's releasing the cortisol. And the cortisol is the building up, you know, it's a stress hormone, but it's also the get up and go hormone. So I'm a big fan of morning exercise. There's a recent study that came out that actually debunked the myth, the notion that doing exercise too close to sleep time is actually a bad thing. So for people who have difficulty with sleep, there should be a little cushion between when you finish your exercise and you're working out and when you actually begin your bedtime. Okay. However, for people who don't have any difficulty sleeping and who have been doing regular physical activity for some time, right, the body acclimates and is able to, you know, all the endorphins and the adrenaline that your body uses to prime you for physical activity, all of those get up and go hormones kind of subside quicker. If you are used to doing a regular physical activity regimen. So your cushion can be slightly smaller. And that's what the recent studies have determined. And I use a very common sense approach to, you know, to physical activity in relation to what time of day. Question? Yeah, you're more than welcome to come see me. Dr. Chediak is very, very good sleep physician and very experienced. I wonder if, you know, if you've already been in for a consultation with him and you've had a sleep study with him, I wonder if he recommended any follow-up for you in order to determine if there's anything else going on. You're more than welcome to come see me. Okay. I'm happy to see you. Question?
I tend to do physical activity late at night, and I was using stimulants like pre-workouts to, you know, be able to get me to go to the gym. I found that it was making me wake up more than what I needed to. When I got out of the gym, I would eat, and then I had trouble sleeping, so I kind of lowered the dosage on that. Do you have a recommended time in which I should eat before I go to bed?
Yeah, you know, typically, again, if you're having sleep concerns, if you are waking up or if you're feeling any reflux at night, I think that it's reasonable to actually increase that cushion in between your last meal and when you fall asleep. I certainly don't recommend using stimulants, stimulants such as caffeine and other stimulants that are very common. We get more and more sensitive to those stimulants as we age. So those people, a lot of times people have come in to me and said, you know, I've been drinking one cup of coffee in the morning every single day for as long as I can remember, but over time my sleep has actually diminished in quality. And a simple intervention, just reducing that cup of coffee to decaf or switching from from a Cuban coffee to a green tea, perhaps something a little more mild. Even that subtle change can actually make a very significant difference. I think that we are already a hyper-stimulated society. So using stimulants on top of that, especially in the context of trying to achieve better results at the gym, it's a very common practice. It's not conducive to good quality sleep. So if you're having any concerns with respect to reflux or any other symptoms concerning your sleep quality, I would increase that cushion in between your last meal and your sleep time. 2 to 3 hours, I think, is a reasonable cushion for you. Question?
Okay, my question. So you said early morning exercise. So it's better to eat your breakfast and exercise or before that?
You know, I think it really depends on the size of your breakfast. And a lot of people, there's a lot of individual variability here. You know, a lot of people like a really hearty breakfast. If that's the case, I would work out before. And a lot of people, you know, get by with just a little, you know, they make a little smoothie, a really small smoothie, or they juice some vegetables, which I'm a big fan of, by the way. They juice some vegetables, and then they go work out. And then they come back and they have either a protein smoothie or like a full-blown breakfast. Green tea, I'm a big fan of green tea also. It's one of my 10 superfoods. So green tea is another thing that you can use in order to kind of give you a little bit of pep, before going for your morning workout. Question?
What are the other 9 superfoods?
Okay. Almonds, turmeric, ginger, blueberries, avocados, soy, garlic. Did I say turmeric already?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, so what is that, 8? Okay. I mean, there's, you know, I also think that some probiotic food like yogurt is a good thing. A lot of people are dairy intolerant. So, plus or minus yogurt. Oh, that's interesting. I'm not aware of any studies on vitamin B6 and its relationship to sleep. The slides that I kind of breezed through at the very end are the ones that these are the ones that are, and this is all retrospective data. So it's not, these are not prospective studies. So there's an association between some of these vitamins and minerals and sleep duration, but there's not a correlation or a causative, there's not a causal effect there. Yeah, and B6 isn't there, so I'm not aware of B6. But if they're having positive, now are you talking about B6 prior to going to sleep? Because I've had actually people have somewhat of a stimulant response to taking B complex or B vitamins prior to going to sleep. But if there's a deficiency, maybe this one. That's interesting. Okay. Thank you for your attention. One more question. Oh, okay. So I like almonds, turmeric, ginger, garlic, avocado, green tea, blueberries. Thank you.